Up next is Ørsted, creating a world that runs entirely on green energy, by Philip Engel, Vice President, Sustainability, Public Affairs, Branding and Marketing at Ørsted. And Philip, I'm delighted to say, is joining us live from Copenhagen. Now, we do have a short Q&A at the end of the session, so do please get involved. Post your questions in via the Slido box on your screen. Philip, a very warm welcome. Over to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. Good morning and good day and good evening to all of you, wherever you are in the world. I'm here to talk about our turnaround from a fossil fuel-based company to a company fully dedicated to renewables. And I'll talk about how brand marketing in two very, very critical junctures helped to catalyze that strategy, that turnaround, and how to really change the company. Me, I'm Philip Engel, and I oversee sustainability, branding, marketing, and public affairs globally at Ørsted. And I have the privilege of having been a part of the entire turnaround from fossil fuels to renewables. But before we dive into that, just allow me to say a couple of words about what we do as a company, because that's necessary to understand our turnaround. So what we do primarily, our main activity is offshore wind. And we do not produce offshore wind turbines, but we put them up and we operate them. And we do that in the US, in Europe, and in Asia. And more we are also turning to onshore wind and solar and storage. And we especially do that in the US, but also moving into Europe. We have been named the most sustainable energy company in the world. And sorry, when I'm looking down here, it's because I need to change slide. There we go. Oh, sorry. There we go. We have been ranked the most sustainable energy company in the world 3 years in a row for that turnaround that I'm going to talk about here. And actually, Harvard Business Review also named our turnaround one of the top 20 business transformations of the last decade, together with some much bigger and probably much, much more well-known companies than us. They ranked our transformation as number seven. So that's where we are today. It wasn't always like that. A bit more than ago, we were a company heavily, heavily reliant on fossil fuels. Our main business activity was to build and operate coal-fired power plants. We mainly did that in Denmark, but we also had a strategy to do that in other countries such as the UK and Germany. We also produced oil and gas in the North Sea. But we realized that it wasn't sustainable. We thought that eventually climate change would become such an important agenda in society and something that all our stakeholders, policymakers, investors, employees, customers, everyone would want us to take action on. So we decided to change and to make a turnaround from fossil fuels to renewables. And frankly, so when you stand here today and you look back, you know, and you see glossy slides, maybe it seems all like a smooth ride. And it also seems natural, I think, to make that transformation in hindsight. But it wasn't back then. I think we were the first European company to really start to do that, European energy company, and probably also one of the first of the bigger energy companies also globally to try to do that. So it was a really, really difficult change. And what we decided to do then was to say that we wanted to have a company that ran much more on renewables. Back in 2008, that was actually when I joined the company fresh out of college, our energy mix was that 15%, only 15% of our energy came from renewables and 85% came from fossil fuels. We wanted to flip that fraction so that by 2040, 85% of our energy would come from renewables and only 15% from fossil fuels. I get back to later how that went and how we managed to actually do that transformation. But that was what we wanted to do. So as a part of that, we wanted to say, of course, that we needed to do something about climate change and reduce our emissions. And that was not easy internally. That was met with a lot of internal opposition. So one of the first important meetings that I was a part of was in this room. There we go. It's a room at our Copenhagen offices, and actually it's a room that our board often uses. It's actually right down the hall from where I stand now. And it was one of the most first important meetings that I had after I started at Ørsted. And what you had in that room, you had representatives from marketing, branding, public affairs, media relations, investor relations, and the theme, the agenda item was to discuss whether we should come out and say something about things. And on one hand, on one side of the table, on the right side, and that's actually where I sat, you had the people who thought that the strategy to go green was the right one and that we needed to come out and say that climate change was a problem and that we wanted to do something about it. On the other side, the left side, you had colleagues who did not think that this was a good idea, that eventually climate change would go away, would be too risky to come out and say something, and that we should sort of rather lay low and not pursue a green strategy. So I'm not saying this to put sort of former or existing colleagues on the spot, but it's just really illustrative of the situation and how much sort of internal discussion and opposition there also was. And it's natural because back then we were one of the leading global companies in building and operating coal-fired power plants. We were actually really, really good at it. And I think it is natural that when someone then tells you that you should stop do that and do something else, that else being to build up an offshore wind business with technology that back then was very immature, there's opposition. It's very human, and I think that's what many companies face when we talk about doing transformations. You know, it is often made to a question of sort of numbers and figures, but very much it's also a question about identity, what we believe in as human beings, who we are. So what did we do then to overcome that opposition and move forward? Well, I mean, we could spend the time to talk about that very interesting story. I think we have to do that at another point in time. But one thing that we did that I do want to talk about was that we actually came out with a lot of communication and brand marketing around this. So we actually launched a campaign in Denmark. Back then, Denmark was our main market, that said clearly that climate change was a problem. We needed to bring down emissions that we at Ørsted had a responsibility to do that, to help reduce those emissions. We did that in a sort of 360-degree campaign, and it had an immense effect. It had a really, really big effect in different ways. One way was that it made it real. It committed us towards our stakeholders that we had to do this and we wanted to make this transformation. To policymakers, to customers, to everyone, and also to our employees. And that was really, really important because it sent the signal that this was the direction and there was no turning back. And actually, at that time, you had colleagues from the division, the business unit that built and operated coal-fired power plants. And I remember that the strategy team there, they didn't really want to make the analysis of how we could make the change from fossil fuels to green energy. They couldn't and they wouldn't. They said it wasn't possible because live unreliable, stuff like that. So it would never work. So they couldn't do the analysis. And to come out with that campaign made it really real that this was the direction we wanted to go. And it made it possible also to take top talent internally and externally and start to build up that new business unit on offshore wind that we want to build up. So back then, we had thousands of people who worked with coal-fired power plants. Today, we have thousands of people, not 1,000, but a lot of people who build and operate offshore wind farms. So that was one very significant change that it actually helped to make the strategy real and set the direction. And it was very important because we did not know how we would realize that ambition of flipping the fraction from 15% from 85% fossil fuels to only 15% and much more green energy. We did not know how we wanted to do that, how we could do that, and we needed to make that plan and that concrete strategy for how to deliver on that. And the brand marketing we came out with really helped to set that direction. So that was the first example. Now, fast forward to 2017, we as a company, we have transformed a lot. at that point in time, we have a lot of green energy already, not 100% at all, but more than 50%. But we as a company are mainly a European company, and we want to expand. We want to help other countries and customers outside of Europe to also decarbonize and to transform in Asia and in the US, for instance. But we have a bit of a challenge to do that. And that is actually our brand and our name at that point in time. So back then, our name was Dong Energy. And Dong Energy, there were several problems with that brand. One, the visual identity is something that very much sends signals of sort of fossil fuels, heavy industry, not so much green energy innovation. The name itself, which actually is an abbreviation for Danish oil and natural gas. And also, I mean, it's not the best name to have if you want to set up shop in the US and grow even more in the UK. Because the word Dong is slang for something in English, and you can look it up yourself if you want to on the internet. So when we did a rebranding, and one of the ads that we ran, this is from The Economist, when we did the rebranding, was actually this. So that explains a bit also why we changed name and wanted to put a smile on the face. So we also wanted to have a new brand strategy and brand platform, because the one we had was very focused on sort of, you know, saying that we are a supplier of green energy. That was pretty much what it was about. So we decided to rebrand, and we did that by changing name to Ørsted. So we changed name, we changed visual identity. We also changed the brand strategy and the brand platform to a much, much more purpose-driven brand, to a brand that's centered around the essence of loving your home, which is the call to action and the tagline of the brand, but also very much about the vision that we formulated of wanting to build a world that runs entirely on green energy. Not alone, of course, but together with our stakeholders. And rather than me talking about the new brand platform, let me show you a film that communicates what that is and what that stands for.
Home. It's not what we think it is. It's not just made of wood or concrete or bricks. Because it's not just a house, let alone a village or a city or a country. Our home is bigger. You may not have explored all its rooms, its passages, wandered its many gardens, bathed in its waters, looked out from the very top floor, nor met all those you live with. This is Latifa, by the way. It's still your home, still mine, still theirs. It's provided all of us with the sustenance and shelter we need to grow and prosper. Our home has treated us well. But as temperatures increase and sea levels rise, it's time to change the way we treat it. It's not easy to change our ways, but if we all look beyond our own walls and see our home for what it really is, it might change you, like it transformed us. Not long ago, we were a fossil fuel company, but we decided to change. Today, we're ranked the most sustainable energy company in the world. And we've already built the world's largest offshore wind operation, enabling millions of people to benefit from the powerful forces of the wind at sea. We want to help create a world that runs entirely on green energy. Because the place we all call home needs love. But love means nothing without action. action.
So this was the hero piece, the hero film of our rebranding. Of course, we had a lot of collateral and content, but this was the hero piece. And up until today, we still use that film. Actually, it's long, but we decided to run it in cinemas, full length, and actually overwhelming response, and ended up being ranked as the third best ad ever in Denmark. So this is the brand we have and where we obviously still stand today. And I have to be honest and say, the rebranding that we did and how our stakeholders responded to that rebranding, it was more than I could have dreamed of. It was from all stakeholders, just a different connection that was established with us, and just a different understanding of who we were and what we stood for as a company, and really that call to action of wanting to build a world and green energy together with them. One particular stakeholder group, our employees again, also really, really responded positively to this. And this is one example where I see that this has had a huge effect. It had the effect that, well, first of all, today when you ask our employees if we have a good brand, a good reputation as us, that they respond that yes, we really do. And it used to be much, much, much lower. Actually, today we score 10 percentage points higher than the global average when it comes to that question. And that's good when you know that the view employees have on the brand is one of the most important drivers of employee satisfaction and motivation, according to surveys and studies. But the second effect was that it really also helped make it clear what our purpose was as a company. And that obviously expressed the strategy, the business strategy that we already had, but it has also had the effect that it has sort of fed back to the strategy and made that even more crisp and sharp in terms of what direction we want to go and what decisions we take as a company on what we invest in. So in that sense, the brand really helped accelerate the business strategy and, if you will, galvanize it. It also, the effect of, as I said, really just giving employees a language to talk about what it is they're doing and where they are, what company they're working for and why. So a massive effect there. So that's the other example of how brand marketing has really, really helped to facilitate the turnaround of the company. And so how did it go with the turnaround? Well, you remember I said that we wanted to flip the fraction from 85% fossil fuels to only 15 and 15 renewables to 85 renewables. That was by 2040. We actually reached that ambition, that target, 2 years ago in 2019. So we thought it would take 30 years. It actually took 10 years. And as for our carbon emissions, so I'm trying to change slide. 1 second, please. There we go. This is the trajectory of carbon emissions reductions that the global energy sector has to be on in order to deliver on 1.5 degrees. And this is the reduction path that we have pursued. So also there, we've reached that 20 years ahead of time. And do we stop there? Then, of course, no, we need to take that next step. And that next step for us is to also help our supply chain and work with our supply chain to decarbonize. So we set a new target to be carbon neutral in our supply chain also by 2040. And that's a decade before what science says is necessary in order to stay within 1.5 degrees. And I think it's sort of that approach that I think we all need to take to transformations. It's hard, it's difficult, and it's very hard because you don't know what's on the other side. And that's the essence of transformations. You can't always quantify the benefits and the risks, but it is the direction that we need to go. And very often, that's at least our experience, once you start to move in that direction, very quickly it becomes exponential change. If you go all in, And you actually made that change quicker than anyone would have thought. Those were the words from me, You saw how our turnaround has happened and how the first example of brand marketing really helped to set the direction and made the strategy possible. And then the second example here helped to accelerate the direction of towards renewable. I think we still have a couple of minutes for questions. Do we?
We do indeed, Philip, and that's amazing. I mean, what a fantastic journey Ørsted has been on. It really is fascinating to hear all that. And congratulations on reaching those targets. I mean, that really is incredible. But yeah, let's get to some of the questions. We have one here. It's quite tricky and it's putting you on the spot. If you could reboot or rebrand another company to make a real positive impact on climate and on climate change, what would it be and why?
So, yeah, it does put me a bit on the spot. Well, I will mention I won't mention any one company, but I would say I would point to some of our competitors, the oil and gas industry, the big players. I say competitors, yes, they are in oil and gas primarily, but they are moving into offshore wind, which of course makes it more difficult for us, but we welcome that competition. But, you know, they are moving into that space, but they're still investing a lot in fossil fuels. Now, one or more of those companies, if they went all in with their giant economic muscles on renewables, all of that, I think that would make a massive change. It would, obviously.
Okay, Philip, thank you so much for joining us from Denmark today. It really has been great to hear you speak.